treat children, and Jim was especially generous in that way. My children loved to go into his writing studio and look at all those weapons that, you know, that he collected, which were the things that were references for many of the objects in his books. And he'd explain each item in great detail and answer their questions with enormous respect. And I think kids know when somebody is, you know, really cares about them, and they know when someone's really listening, and they always call Jim and Harriet Jim and Harriet. They were never Mr. and Mrs. Rigney, and of course they encouraged that. Generosity was an art form, and it still is, in the Rigney household. One year I was teaching school, and a student of mine who's here tonight, Noelle, had pneumonia, and she was very sick, and it was Christmas, and I thought, I will get her a signed copy of Jim's new book, because she loved Robert Jordan books, and she wrote fantasy. And I was going to buy the book and bring it over there and have Jim sign it, and I woke up one morning, and there was a big box of signed Robert Jordan books sitting on the stoop with a sticky note attached, and Harriet and Jim had just dropped them off because they thought it was the right thing to do. They'd never even met Noelle. And the next year, they became her mentors. And when Harriet helped Noelle win the Post and Courier scholarship to the University of South Carolina, I'll never forget, Jim and Harriet called me on the phone. They were like crying. They were so thrilled. It was like their daughter had won this scholarship. And they thanked me for introducing them to her. You know, I could tell stories like this for hours. A couple of quick stories. After September 11th, I remember Jim wanted so badly to go over and speak to the troops with, was it the USO, you know? Soldiers are Wheel of Time fans, as the librarian mentioned. And I don't know how many of you heard this famous story. I don't know if I'm telling it right, but it's a great story. Who cares? About the young man, I think he was in Iraq, and he had Jim's new book in his breast pocket, and he was shot, and the bullet went into the book instead of his heart. You've seen the books. You know how thick they are. Jim loved that story. Didn't he love that story? And then here's another great story about the round-trip limousine ride, courtesy Harriet's laugh. I wanted to make Harriet laugh. Courtesy of Jim's publisher, all the way to Winston-Salem, North Carolina. We were going to a book festival, and they were sending a limo, and they said, well, why don't you come along? And we found out in the course of this trip that a limousine does not go through the Burger King drive-thru. Anyway. Harriet and Jim both served on the board of the Low Country Initiative for the Literary Arts, also called LILA, which was really named by them. And they embraced this fledgling organization in ways that embody their generosity and sense of humor, because they created an actual character named Lila, who wore, what was it, she...
red stilettos with ankle socks.
Yes.
And she drove an old...
That's right.
Convertible.
Yeah.
She was disreputable,
yeah. In a good way. You know, that's Lila. I knew you'd do that for me. The humor that characterized Jim and Harriet was constant and enduring. Even when Jim was being treated at the Mayo Clinic, he would send those hysterical emails that read like short stories, actually, in which he referred to the nurses who were drawing his blood as vampires and so on. I think a person's true character is revealed during the course of any crisis. And Jim's confidence in the face of this devastating illness was exemplary. He never let it get the upper hand. And I think we all have learned a lot from his resilience. He fought this battle so bravely, like the soldier that he was, with grace and humor, integrity and honor. He had to be so public about something so private, and he ended up inspiring so many people who were dealing with the same kind of illness. But the most important story to me of Jim's life is the love story of Jim and Harriet. It's the kind of story that makes you believe in love and fate and all the good things we want to think about the human heart. They were, quite simply, meant to be together. The story of some of Jim's moments continues to astonish me, and I'm glad Greg Smith, I don't know where you went, there you go, somewhere. He was the priest who gave Jim his last rites, and he told me that Jim participated in this. And what that says about Jim's spirit and his mind, I'm not sure. Greg and I have talked about this, but I think it suggests a genius and a fully realized soul. So very Jim. A few months before his death, my son Hunter, who's still filming, was doing a student film. And he was making a film about Charleston writers, and Jim agreed to do this interview with him. And Jim told him that he would write a dozen more books, and he'd live for decades. And he said all he wanted to be said about him was that he told a good story. These stories will live forever in the hearts of those who knew him and the collective imagination of millions of readers and those whose lives were touched by his words. Thank you so much for formally honoring our dear friend, Jim Rigney.